Hi, welcome to SGT University. I am Dr. Saurav from Faculty of Physiotherapy. Today, we will be learning about median nerve injury.
Anatomy. The median nerve is a major peripheral nerve of the upper limb. The median nerve is derived from the medial and lateral cord of the brachial plexus. It contains fibers from root C6 to T1 and can contain fibers from C5 in some individuals. After originating from the brachial plexus, in the axilla, the median nerve descends down the arm, initially lateral to the brachial artery. Halfway down the earth, the nerve crosses over the brachial artery and becomes situated medially. The median nerve enters the anterior compartment of the forearm via the cubital fossa. In the forearm, the nerve travels between the flexor digitorum profundus and flexor digitorum superficialis muscles. The median nerve gives off two major branches in the forearm, anterior introcious nerve and palmar cutaneous nerve. Anterior introcious nerve supplies the deep muscles in the anterior forearm. Palmar cutaneous nerve innervates the skin of the lateral palm. After giving off the anterior introcious and palmar cutaneous branch, the median nerve enters the hand via the carpal tunnel, where it terminates by dividing into two branches, recurrent branch and palmar distal branch. The recurrent branch innervates the thinner muscle, and the palmar distal branch innervates the palmar surface and fingertip of the lateral 3.5 digits. It also innervates the lateral 2 lumbrical muscles. Now, let us see the motor functions. The median nerve innervates the majority of the muscles in the anterior forearm and some intrinsic hand muscles. Anterior forearm. In the forearm, the median nerve innervates the muscle in the superficial and intermediate layer. In superficial layer, the muscles are pronator teres, flexor carpi radialis, and palmaris longus. In intermediate layer, the muscle is flexor digitorum superficialis. The median nerve also gives rise to the anterior introcious nerve, which supplies the deep flexors. In deep layer, the muscles are flexor pollicis longus, pronator quadratus, and the lateral half of the flexor digitorum profundus. In general, these muscles perform pronation of the forearm, flexion of the wrist, and flexion of the digits of the hand. In the hand, the median nerve innervates some of the muscles in the hand via two branches. The recurrent branch of the median nerve innervates the thinner muscle, muscle associated with the movement of the thumb. The palmar distal branch innervates the lateral 2 lumbricals. These muscles perform flexion at the metacarpophalangeal joint and extension at the interpharyngeal joint of the index and middle fingers. Now let us see the sensory function. The median nerve is responsible for the cutaneous innervation of the part of the hand. This is achieved via two branches, palmar cutaneous branch and palmar distal cutaneous branch. Palmar cutaneous branch arises in the forearm and travels into the hand. It innervates the lateral aspect of the palm. This nerve does not pass through the carpal tunnel and is spared in carpal tunnel syndrome. Palmar distal cutaneous branch arises in the hand, innervates the palmar surface and fingertip of the lateral 3.5 digits.
Now let us find the clinical relevance of median nerve injury.
Clinical relevance. Carpal tunnel syndrome. Compression of the median nerve within the carpal tunnel can cause carpal tunnel syndrome. It is the most common mononeuropathy and is caused by an increased tissue pressure within the carpal tunnel. Clinical features include numbness, tingling, and pain in the distribution of the median nerve. Importantly, the palm is usually spared, as the palmar cutaneous branch does not travel through the carpal tunnel. Symptoms can wake the patient from sleep and are usually worse in morning. If left untreated, chronic carpal tunnel syndrome can cause weakness and atrophy of the thinner muscles. Another clinical relevance is lesion of the median nerve. The lesion of the median nerve mainly seen at the elbow or at the wrist. The damage at the elbow. The mechanism of the injury may be supracondylar fracture of the humerus. Now let us see what are the changes will occur in the motor function. The flexor and the pronator in the forearm are paralyzed with the expectation of the flexor carpi ulnaris and medial half of the flexor digitorum profundus. The forearm constantly supinated and wrist flexion is weak. Flexion of the thumb is also prevented as both of the longus and brevis muscle are paralyzed. The lateral two lumbricals are affected and the patient will not able to flex at the MCP joint or extend at IP joint of the index and middle finger. Now let us see the impact on the sensory function. Lack of sensation over the areas that the median nerve innervates. Characteristic sign: the thinner eminence is wasted due to atrophy of the thinner muscles. If patient tries to make a fist, only the little and the ring finger can flex completely. This result in a characteristic shape of the hand known as hand of benediction. Damage at the wrist. The mechanism of injury may be laceration just proximal to the flexor retinaculum. Motor function. Thinner muscles paralyzed as are the lateral two lumbricals. This affect opposition of the thumb and flexion of the index and middle fingers. Sensory function. Lack of sensation over the area that the median nerve innervates. Characteristic sign. The hand is held in the same position as damaged at the elbow, but the forearm is unaffected.
Now let us see the causes of median nerve injury related to different site of injury.
Causes. Median nerve can be involved anywhere along the course, at the axilla, axillary aneurysm, traction injury, at the arm, penetrating injury, at the elbow, penetrating injury, Hansen's disease, golfer's elbow, supracondylar fracture, at the wrist, glass cut injury, can cause isolated involvement at the median nerve or along with the ulnar nerve. Carpal tunnel syndrome. Signs and symptoms.
The symptom of the median nerve injury may depend upon the mechanism of injury of an individual.
Sensory. There will be loss of sensation over the volar aspect of the lateral 3.5 fingers up to the distal phalanx on the dorsal side, skin overlying the thinner eminence. Motor. The muscles supplied by the median nerve, namely the pronator teres, flexor carpi radialis, flexor digitorum superficialis, palmaris longus, flexor digitorum profundus, pronatus quadratus, flexor pollicis longus, thinner muscles, the first and second lumbricals. Deformity. The deformity seen in median nerve palsy are as follows depending upon the site and extent of lesion. The commonest deformity seen is ape hand or monkey hand, which occur due to flattening of the thinner eminence, lack of opposition of the thumb, because of which the thumb is held beside the index finger due to overaction of the adductor pollicis and extensor pollicis longus. Partial claw hand occur due to paralysis of the first and second lumbricals. Pointing index finger, when there is a higher lesion involving even the longer flexor of the hand, on asking to make a fist, the index finger will point forward. This happens because the patient attempt to make a fist, the profundus tendon of the ring finger will pull the middle finger into partial flexion, leaving the index finger in extension and pointing forward. Functional disability. Most of the patient with median nerve palsy will be having difficulty in holding both big and small object. Their activity with the involved hand is generally clumsy because they cannot hold object confidently in their hand, nor they can appreciate the sensation of the object unless and until they see the object. Physical examination. Inspection. In inspection, we will see the thinner wasting, atrophy of pulp of the index, cracking of the nail and other tropic changes, cigarette burn or other sensory loss, pointing finger in higher nerve lesion. Special test, tunnel test and Phalen test are the fundamental importance for the diagnosis of carpal tunnel syndrome. Tunnel sign. In tunnel sign, the examiner tap the nerve in the carpal tunnel to elicit pain in median nerve distribution. In Phalen's maneuver, the examiner holds the wrist in flexion for 60 seconds to elicit numbness, pain in median nerve distribution. ULTT1, that is upper limb tension test 1 for median nerve. ULTT2A, that is upper limb tension test 2A for median nerve bias. Diagnosis. The diagnostic test for the median nerve injury is electromyography, nerve conduction study. Note, if the history and physical exam are inconclusive to differentiate between the nerve root injury and the distal median nerve injury, electromyography and nerve conduction study are the diagnostic option. A nerve conduction test can detect impaired in the median nerve conduction across the carpal tunnel while having normal conduction along anywhere else in its path. An EMG, that is electromyography, can be used to determine if there is pathology within the muscle innervated by the median nerve. The next diagnostic tests are MRI and X-ray. Management.
Now let us discuss the management of the median nerve injury.
Management of the median nerve injury depends on the etiology. Passive movement to the wrist and fingers to keep the part mobile. Gentle stretching of the long flexors to prevent any form of tightness. Interrupted galvanic stimulation to all the muscles supplied by the median nerve. Care of the anesthetic hand. Splints. Opposition splints are given to maintain the thumb in opposition and also to prevent contracture of the first wave space. The two types of splints which are commonly given are C-bar and cock-up splint. Surgical management. Surgery should be considered in patients with symptoms that do not respond to conservative measures and in patients with severe nerve entrapment as evident by nerve conduction study. Thinner atrophy or motor weakness. It is important to note that surgery may be effective even if a patient have normal nerve conduction study. The nerve can be repaired by direct suturing, nerve grafting, nerve transfers and other reconstructive procedures such as tendon transfers. Direct suturing. Nerve repair is done when there is nerve discontinuity. An end-to-end repair is the method of choice. Nerve grafting. In situations when reconstruction of the peripheral nerve injury is difficult due to segmental defects or gaps in the nerve, nerve grafting can be helpful. tendon transfer. Tendon transfer is still the most commonly used technique for motor reconstruction in chronic cases.
So today we have covered the median nerve injury. In our next lecture, we will be learning about sciatic nerve injury. Keep learning, keep growing. See you next time.